It is time for worship. I hope you come in to the Lord's house this morning with a joyful heart. Amen. Well, about four of you. We got work to do this morning. I just want to take a moment before we enter into our worship songs today to recognize our teen talent participants who went up this past week, and some of them spent the week there performing for the judges, for the crowd that was there. I'm so proud of Elijah, was able to watch him by live stream, and just was able to rejoice and worship with him. He did such a great job, him and Abby. They did a great job with their drama. Haley, she did a great job, and she brought home hardware. I told them this morning, I like a woman who has hardware. So, and she was one of the runner-ups and the female vocal solo, but to us, she's a worshiper. And one who lifts her voice, the gift that God has given her in worship. Would you just give her a great hand and all the participants today?
Y'all having a good time this morning? I want y'all to put your hands together for this one. I love you.
promise scripture this week comes from Psalm 100. Make a joyful shout to the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Let's give him praise in this house this morning. We praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
I've got nothing to lose.
Thank you. You are holy. Can you just focus on who Jesus is right now? Worship Him. We worship you, Jesus.
Are you, Lord?
with everyone in this house watching my live stream also. Would you just say the word holy with me? Holy. Again, holy. Holy. Lord, you are great. You're mighty. We worship you in this place. I just throw up my hands and I praise you again and again and again, because I can't praise you enough. You are holy. You are holy. You are holy. You are holy. Yes, Lord. He is holy. This is that moment when I take all of who I am and I surrender all of who I am to the Lord in worship. If you're not worshiping right now, it's because you're absolutely choosing not to. His presence is here. Just begin to say, holy are you, Lord. Worship him. Lord, we press into your presence. You are holy. Lord, our worship to you is one of the most important things we can do on this earth. Probably the most important thing. We worship you. We call on your name right now. And Lord, as we enter into a time of prayer for the needs of the people, I ask the prayer team to come on down. And Lord, I pray as they step out and make their way down that you give us a special anointing today for this time of prayer ministry. Some may think it's just another part of the service, Lord, but I don't. I think this is a time when we become totally dependent on you. And we lift the needs. And Lord, as I pray for these needs today, I invite anyone in this room to come down and let a member of the prayer team pray with you. It doesn't matter if it's a physical, emotional, spiritual need. Come down and let them pray with you. Lord Jesus, would you guide our prayers? Guide my prayer. Guide the prayers of each member of the prayer team today. Even prayers offered from people watching right now, people in this room. Lord, this is a time when we lift our needs to the throne of God. We lift up these to you today. Speak to us, Holy Spirit. May we just lift up our hands everywhere. Lord, I surrender myself. I feel that there's a drawing this morning to worship you and surrender to you. Lord, there's families right now that is in a time of grief.
Lord, the Heron family, there's been two deaths, tragic death. Lord, would you wrap arms of love and mercy around them today and comfort. And Lord, the police officer that perished this week doing what he was called to do to help people. He gave the ultimate sacrifice. We honor his sacrifice today, but we pray for those, his family, the officers that work with him, with Jen. Lord, I pray for her this morning that the Holy Ghost would just wrap loving arms of love and comfort around her this morning. Lord, Stephen Peel's family, the tragic death of one of his cousins, wrap arms of comfort and love around them. Lord, for Alicia Wyatt this morning, who needs a miracle from on high. Lord, we pray for her. We pray for John and Brenda. We pray for an infusion of strength for all of them. And we call on the healer to touch Alicia today and to raise her up from this affliction she's going through. Lord, for Marty Ward, who had a heart attack last night, Will alerted me to it. We lift him up to you and his family, Lord. Touch him. For Desiree, who has a brain bleed from a fall, Lord, cease that completely. Bring healing to her. For Edwin, who's dealing with a fever and some infection, Lord, bring the healing power to him today. For Nick, Lord, we lift him up to you, knowing that you're able to bring the strength and healing that he needs. For Brother Joe Smith, recovering from a stroke, Lord, touch him. For Erica and Gary, who's dealing with cancer, Lord, we lift these to you, knowing that you have all power to heal. Lord, you're here to heal today. Lord, for William Brown Jr., I lift him to you that all of the symptoms would leave his body from his fall, that he would find new strength today. For Greg Limley and his wife, we lift them to you, knowing that you're able to touch them where they're at today. For Bill, Karen, and Joyce, who's recovering, Lord, touch them today. Bring healing to them. Chad Bryant, who needs a heart transplant. Connie Posey, who needs a touch. Baby Thora, we're holding on to for complete healing. Danielle Toby, who had a terrible accident this week, multiple broken bones, already had two surgeries this weekend and more to come. Touch her where she's at today. Lord, you're great to help us in these times when we need you the most. We need you every day, every hour, every minute. But there's times when we're going through something and we need the miracle worker to show up. We need the way maker to show up in our life. Lord, would you touch all needs today?
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the worship angels sweet. I see glory on each face.
Yes, Lord, I feel your presence. I just encourage anyone right now that would like a refreshment from on high to just begin to ask the Lord, would you touch me afresh this morning? It might be the stress from work. It might be the stress from relationships. It might be the stress from someone going through a difficult time health-wise, emotional-wise. Would you just minister to all of us this morning, Lord? Bring the healing that's needed, Lord. Yes, Lord, your presence is here. Lord, may our hearts be open to you. As we move forward this service, Lord, today, I don't want anything in my mind blocking my ability to hear the word of the Lord. So, Lord, right now I'm going to lead everybody through a prayer of trying to push every distraction out of the way. Push lunch out of the way. Put something later today out of the way. Because it's in this moment right now when the Lord wants us to hear Him speak to us. So are we just clear our hearts, our minds of the troubles of life, so that we hear you clearly today? Lord, I pray that this morning as pastor over this congregation. Lord, we need to make sure our heart is open to you. We need to make sure that our mind is open to you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Can you just give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Oh, come on. You've got more than that. The Lord is great and greatly to be praised. We worship you, O Lord. Lord, you are worthy of all things. You may be seated. Rachel's going to come in a moment, and I'm going to have her introduce this Freedom in Christ to you. This class is going to start on Wednesday night, the 16th, and we're going to start trying some different things on Wednesday night, and this is one of them. And if you are here following the John study that we're doing, those lessons are on our website. the Thursday following, the Wednesday we do them. So you won't miss anything if you choose to go to this class. I want Rachel to share her heart with you for a moment.
This has been in the works for like a year. I've been periodically meeting with the pastor concerning this, and the last time we met, I told him, I said, now, you know, I made a C in public speaking in college, so this is not my forte. Some of you know who I am. Some don't necessarily know me. My husband and I sort of sit quietly three-quarters of the way back in the middle. But I've been a Christian since I was 19 years old. I'm 53 now. I'm married to Jack Duncan. I've been a nurse for 32 years, and in saying those things, those are truthful facts about my life. I could become delusional and say, I think I'm a welder and I'm married to Jack Smith, but those things aren't true. I could believe them if I wanted, but it would cause complications in my life, and I would not be successful at welding because I don't know how to do that. But how often do we do that similar thing in our spiritual life? We believe in Jesus and we love him to the extent that we know he's our Savior and that he's going to meet us in heaven one day. But we'll believe things in our mind about ourselves that's not what he says of us. Do we have a true foundation for what our identity is in Christ? In Psalms 11:3, it says, if the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Currently in our culture, I identify as is everywhere. I identify as XYZ. You can just fill in the blank. So in our Christian walk, do we identify as I'm chronically ill, or I'm depression, or I'm anxiety? Do we identify as those things solely instead of identifying as Christ's child and what he has for us? When we were in planning, I called a few different people who had actually used this material, and I personally have used it a couple of times through my life. Dedicated solely to renewing my mind during some really difficult times, but it's something that you do daily. But I did contact a minister who was not in this denomination. It's a very strong denomination, and he had told me, he said, well, we did that, but it turned into sort of like a deliverance ministry, and I didn't know how I felt about that. So I mentioned that to the pastor, and he just looked at me and was like, well, isn't Jesus in the business of delivering people? Isn't that what he does? So I just disregarded that minister's comment, even though, you know, at first it was a little disconcerting to me. In 1 Corinthians 2:6, it tells us that we've been given the mind of Christ. And when you read that, like, what does that really mean? How do we use that in our lives? We have to choose to believe his truth versus what we hear from the world, what we hear from our own flesh, what we hear from the devil. So those are the primary components in doing this study, is that we learn how to perform spiritual battle with our mind, the devil, and the world. So if you're interested in this type of teaching, please give me a call or mention it to the pastor. At the foyer, in front of each of the donation boxes, I've put a little bookmark that has some of the scripture references that we'll be using if you'd like to pick one up. And this is not just for women. This is for men and women, and 16 and up is sort of directed more toward adults. They do have other children and youth versions, but the one we have is the adult version. And this is not about freedom in Christ, but Jennifer, I wanted to tell you that despite your grief, God's still sovereign, and he knows our grief.
and He's there with us in our grief. And if this congregation loves you, and we just want to wrap our arms physically around you and be Jesus to you today and to all of your co-workers as well.
Before I preach this morning, I want to recognize some of our young adults who's heading to college this week. Be Elijah, Massey, Isaiah, and Carissa. Is that all? Let's stand. Come on. Do y'all like those little noodle things? You know, the little noodles you do in the microwave? I hope you do. Let's stand together this morning for the word. I always feel it's important for us to honor the Word of God and stand for the reading as often as we can. I'm going to read from Philippians chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. This is three verses of a prayer that Paul is writing out to the church at Philippi. He's in prison, and he's writing this to us. And I find it very, very revealing about his heart toward God with the writing that he gave us while he was in prison. Starting with verse 9, he says, "In this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment, that you may approve the things which are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness which are by Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God." Can you say amen? Amen? Lord Jesus, as I prayed a few moments ago, this is your time to speak to us. Lord, I just want to be your vessel, your conduit this morning to speak what you have laid in my spirit concerning this time today. But Lord, it's your word. We're going to share the scriptures and try to point ourselves to the power of the word living out in our life every single day. And everything we do, that the Word of God is involved in our life, giving us the direction, the guidance, the wisdom that we need. Lord, we open our minds, our hearts to what you want to say to us today. And I pray this in the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. You may be seated. I have a question for you this morning. What if you could see life from God's point of view? It would probably be different than the view that we're using right now. Probably be a little different than the view we have on Monday morning or any morning. But I'm just wondering sometimes if we spin our wheels living life just in our own sight, in our own insight, and with just what we can see. Yesterday, I had opportunity to drive through Greenville. How life? It wasn't too bad where I was at, but it can be bad. But I went by Dunkin' Donuts. How many of you know what a Dunkin' Donuts is? They're pretty good, right? Well, I seen this neon LED sign blinking these words as big as they could get them on the screen, saying, "Under new management." Now, I reckon why they were having to tell everybody they're under new management. Because they weren't dunking too good. Something had gone wrong with their dunker. So they're telling everybody, all their customers, "We're under new management." I wonder if we really pull ourselves under that sign saying, "I'm under new management." No longer am I, Steve Knight, going to call the shots, but I yield myself to Jesus. What if you could see life from God's point of view? Now, I know what some of you are thinking right now. Some of you are thinking, well, I can't do that. I'm not God. But we have His Word. And see, that's where we gain the insight that God wants us to live with, is us getting into His Word, allowing the Holy Spirit to ingrain in us what we're supposed to do from God's Word. Romans 12:2, a very powerful verse of Scripture, says, "And do not be conformed to this world, but be what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind." Now that's good if it stopped there. There was a period, but it goes on to say that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You see, the only way for us to truly be transformed by the renewing of our mind is if we allow God to become the manager of our life. If we allow His Word to be the thing that we bring in, the knowledge that we bring in. The text said today that you may be sincere and without offense, but it's when we get the knowledge of the Word of God in us and we yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit. You see, to be transformed means there's a dramatic change. Look over at your neighbor and ask them, have you changed? Oh, Lord, I'm seeing some sad looks. There should be an evidence of change in a person's life when they're saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. Renewing implies a restoration of what had become faded or distorted in our life. In other words, we need to be made like new, how God wants us to be. And I prayed that a while ago. I didn't have that in my mind. I believe the Holy Spirit led me to pray that we are to clear our minds, our hearts of distractions and things that's preoccupying our mind. I get a little amused sometimes when I hear somebody talk about the same problem over and over and over and over and over in their mind. I'm thinking, why are you renting out space to the devil in your mind? Some people need to kick him out and evict him out of your mind and out of your heart. You're giving him too much room in your life. The mind is the functioning sector of our being. And so we need that transformed and renewed mind. And to prove it out means that there's an existence in us of truth. Is there an existence of truth in us today? Is there an existence of validity, of genuineness in us? You know, I think sometimes we spend more time looking at the other person than we do ourselves. I want a God's view for my life. And to bring our life into His will means that we're in alignment with the Lord. Now, some people might say, you know, this is a little controversial, Pastor Steve. No, it's not really controversial. If you feel like it's controversial, then maybe you haven't been renewed in your mind. You see, when we are touched by the Spirit of God, something else begins to think and function in our mind. The way we respond and react to things in life is differently. These verses sum it up like this in Ephesians 4, verses 20 through 24. Paul writes, "But you have not so learned Christ." Now, what that statement means right there is like stated in contrast to unbelievers. Verse 21, "If indeed you have heard Him," heard Christ, "and have been taught by Christ as the truth is in Jesus." Verse 22 says that you put off concerning your former conduct The old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. You see, there's a correlation here to what we're trying to be taught from Scripture. Verse 24 says, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. We are to allow the Word of God and the Spirit of God to come together in us to transform our life to where when we live as someone who is righteous and someone who is holy. I've been trying to combat this thing about holiness, about people saying, well, I'm not righteous and I'm not holy. You might want to rethink that, because if the blood of Jesus Christ has washed you clean, He's declared you righteous. And you're allowing this world that tries to make out like everybody's the same, everybody is not the same. There's going to be a day when we're going to be challenged. We're either going to prove it out to God or we're not. So the question today is, how are we renewed, transformed, changed? It's when the truth of Jesus replaces the old man's truth that's inside of us. How do we prove the will of God in our life? That we put on the new man and we live a life of righteousness and holiness. Thank you for that. Because this is where I think we have the biggest struggle with the flesh and the world, is because we don't stop ourselves enough when we're tempted to sin. Spiritual growth is never to be placed on pause. God help me this morning. I think sometimes we think this is optional to us. And I know our school system has booted this out. And somewhere along the line, there's some sinners that overrode the Christians standing up for the Word of God being taught in the school system. I don't know exactly when. I didn't take time to research it, because I can't go back and do anything about yesterday, but I'm going to try to drive a stake in the ground today about where we go from here. Your child's not going to get this in school, so it needs to happen before they go to school. We need to take that time, and not only them, but you, the parent. Because they're going to listen to what you read from the Word, and then they're going to judge you by it. We don't like that, though, do we? See, the apostle saying in this text that we're to allow the love of God to abound in us so that we grow more in knowledge and all discernment. Now, the discernment in this particular scripture is talking about where we, matter of fact, the King James Version has the word judgment there. And what that's talking about is where we allow the Word of God to create in me and in you, when you absorb it into your life, it creates some righteous boundaries, some righteous guardrails that you live with in your life. And the Bible is supposed to help us have that discernment. When I begin to go outside of it, that godly conviction that I've allowed the Word of God and the Holy Spirit to set up in my life will help protect me, because it will call it to my attention. You say, will it really do that? It has for me. Anybody else? Can I get a witness anywhere? It helps me. He says, so that you may approve the things that are excellent, that you may be genuine, sincere, that you may be without offense. In other words, blameless. I don't want anybody to be able to blame me for something. If you do, come to me. Let me work it out. Because it says until the day of Christ. When you allow something to stay in your life that shouldn't be there, if you're holding something against somebody else, you're better off to let that thing go. Because it'll wrestle you down if you don't. Until the day of Christ means we don't give up on our spiritual growth. And when we do that, there's fruits of righteousness that come into our life. Have you ever seen anybody that displays joy in their heart, peace in their mind? You know anybody like that? Oh, y'all must have drama queens in your family. It starts with living a biblical life. First thing I want to teach this morning is the Bible is a book of promise which establishes our hope. And John Maxwell's book that he wrote, Change Your World, he writes this statement, hope has two daughters, one named anger and one named courage. He says the anger is so that you look at the way things are and you're angry enough to do something about it. And courage to make a difference in that. And I love what he's saying here because the Word of God gives us the hope. It's a full book of promises that establishes hope in me. My hope is not contingent on what happens in this service. It's not contingent what happens tomorrow. My hope is contingent on the Word of God and God promising me through His Word that He'll take care of us as believers. See, the devil is out to diminish your faith, to chip away at your commitment any way he can. You see, your commitment to Christ is supersede anything that comes up in your life every day. Someone said, well, I had a bad moment. Well, I've had some too. But they usually wind up putting me on my knees. I don't want anything to steal the promises of God out of me. For me to be transformed, I'm going to say it like this, but I want you to understand why I'm saying it like that. It starts with me. I've got to be willing to get in this book and say, Holy Spirit, transform me. So if I'm going to do it, I've got to be the one to say, I'm going to do this, Lord. Transform me. I can't do it in my power, but I can be willing for Him to do it in me. Romans 15:13 says, now may the God of hope, I love that, fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. I came upon an accident not too long ago. And when I went out to see if the people were okay, I was rushing with some urgency in my step. And I was going there and I was looking, and the first person I saw in the vehicle, there was a lot of blood running down their head. I knew that they had hit their head. And I was, I don't know about you, but blood gets my attention. You know, it's shocking. You see that? And I immediately felt like, oh, I need to help them. And I thought, I can't help them more by just going over there and touching them. I got to pray for them. There's people that's coming that's going to help them hands on, but I need to pray. And see, in that moment, even when it may not look that good, I believe I told the group on Wednesday night about the young man in the other car. I went over and prayed with him, and he had his Bible beside him. And when I started praying, he reached over and he got it and he held it against himself. He told me, I can't feel my legs. And he and I prayed, and a lady came over and she joined us in prayer. See, I love it when it gets real and people say, you know what? It's time to call on God. We began to call on God. That young man was praying. And I said, can you feel your legs? He said, no, I can't. And I said, Lord, you know what he needs? And so I stepped back so others could come in, and of course the medics went to the other car first. She seemed worse in that moment. And I looked back and I seen that young man climb out of that car. And I began to just thank the Lord. You say, was it your prayer? No. Look, don't get caught up in your ability. Get caught up in His ability. It was God that did the work. See, in our text, Philippians 1:9, Paul's praying that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge. This word in the Greek really describes an advanced knowledge. In other words, you're willing to allow the Bible to come into your life to make a difference. See, biblical love is not some empty, sentimental type love. It is something that will grow deep inside you and begin to enrich your life and bring transformation to you. 1 Peter 1:22 says it this way, since you have purified your souls in what? Obeying the truth. Yeah, that's the key, is that we align our life with truth from God's Word. Through the Spirit and sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. It might ought to be time for us to stop and just have an old-fashioned hugging service. Look, I'm going to say this, and I don't know of anything. I don't preach that way. I follow the Spirit as best as I can. But if you've got something you're holding against somebody, your soul's not pure. He's saying here, the Apostle Peter, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit and sincere love of the brethren, then he kind of brings this in as a bookend to this, love one another fervently with a pure heart. Now, this water, the label says pure life. That's why I like it. I don't know that it helps me have a pure life, because the Word of God, obeying the Word of God, helps me to love one another. And see, the love is about us being yielded to have a greater knowledge of who God is. That's how I begin to have a God point of view in my life, that I no longer see things just from my vantage point, but I can see things through the Spirit of God, how He wants me to see it. When the Apostle Peter stood up on the day of Pentecost, he quoted the prophet Joel when he said that there'll be dreams and visions given. I declare it's time for us to be yielded to the Spirit of God for dreams and visions to come into our life, for our families, for our children, for our work, everything in our life. Because when we do that, Romans 8:28 says we know all things work together for what? Good to those who love God. See, there's a proof statement in there. To those who love God, to those who are the called according to His purpose. A lot of truths in that one verse of Scripture. We know. That's why I want to make sure I'm in the Word of God, so I know every day who my Savior is, who the leader of my life is, that God works. I need to know in my life that God works every single day in all things. I'm tired of these compartmental situations happening in people's lives where they put their spiritual life over here in this box, and Monday through Saturday they live out of this other box that's full of carnality. There's no purity in that. You're calling on God and you've got other stuff in your life. He says He'll work together for good to those who love God. When you love God, you're willing to push all the carnality out of your life. Oh boy, it's gotten quiet. I'm nervous now. Second thing, the Bible is a book of prophecy, which instills in us expectation. I'm going to read you two verses of Scripture that explain something. 2 Peter 1:21 says, for prophecy never came by the will of man. This is not just me talking. The Word of God all the men that wrote the Word of God was moved on by the Spirit. But holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Then there's another verse I want to share with you in Amos 3:7. Surely the Lord God does nothing unless He reveals His secret to His servants, the prophets. So as you take in the Word of God, we'll understand that God always reveals His secret to us if we're in tune with Him. Example, Genesis 6, God told Noah, what? A flood's coming. So he built an ark to save his household. In Genesis 18, God warned Abraham of the pending judgment of Sodom. You remember, we talked about that a few weeks ago, how that Abraham bickered with God, negotiated with Him. But the judgment came. See, He always reveals that. And you're saying, well, will He do that in my life? If you're in tune with God's Word and His Spirit, He'll begin to let you in on things that's coming. Case in point, I've had the Lord put people on my heart to pray for. I begin praying for them, not knowing what's going on. And when I reach out to them, is everything okay? They come back and they tell me, this is going on. And I realize the Spirit of God was prompting us to pray. We need to pay attention to God. We need to pay attention to His voice. He speaks to us. See, this week, China and Russia conducted a joint naval operation off the coast of Alaska. I don't know if that gets you alarmed or not, but it gets me alarmed. America had to send 4 destroyers out there to turn back 11 of their ships. You say, well, that happened over there. No, it's part of the last days. I'm telling you, the Lord is coming. Jesus said it this way in Luke 21, verse 10. He said, then He said to them, nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there will be great earthquakes in various places, and famines, and pestilences. You know what that word pestilences mean, right? Diseases. COVID, cancer, heart disease, pestilences. And there will be fearful sights and great signs from heaven. Jesus said in verse 12, but before all these things, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and prisons. You'll be brought before kings and rulers for My name's sakes. But it will turn out for you as an occasion for testimony. Case in point, Paul's in prison, and he's writing to us today the text we read and we're sharing from. Jesus knew we would face things. A 19-year-old got arrested this week in Wisconsin. He had asked City Hall, can I be outside the barrier of this park where they were going to have a LGBTQ, Google, I don't know what all those letters are, but they were going to have that event, but it was catered to children. Had all these rides and blow-ups for children, and this 19-year-old and some other people from his church, they were on the outside of there, and they were trying to tell everybody going in, God loves you, Jesus loves you, Jesus can save you. He got arrested. And when he asked him, why are you arresting me? I asked permission to be here. He said, because you're using an amplifier. You see, there's going to be times when we're going to be pressed. But Jesus is saying, use it to testify of me. But for us to be ready, we need to be abounding still more and more in knowledge. Look at our text in verse 9 there. That your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment. Discernment means having a moral compass to see things in. In other words, a filter of what is right and what is wrong. Paul wanted us to be aware so that we're ready for what's coming. He wrote in 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 21, 22, test all things. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. As we gain a more understanding of the Bible, we have a different view of morality, of how we should behave. And when we allow the Spirit of God and the Bible to create those filters, those judgments in our life, that we don't do the wrong thing, because you never know who's watching you. I had someone testify to me this week of how that they used to work at this place, and since they worked at that place, they had had a closer walk with the Lord, and they got sent back to that place, and somebody actually said, I notice a difference in you. You see, that's what it should be, is we should be growing to where people notice. You say, well, you don't know how hard my life is. I don't know, you know. Maybe you want to ride with me. I don't know. But can I tell you something today? And I put this in your outline. For the unbeliever, this life is as good as it gets. But for the believer, this life is as bad as it gets. We've got something waiting on us that's far better than this world. It's to be with Jesus and to live with Him and praise Him around His throne. The Bible is a book of promise. It builds expectation. I'm looking for something better. And when we prayed around this altar this morning, the people we prayed for, I expect God to work in their bodies, in their lives, in their situations. We're to trust God in what He's doing. Last point today, the Bible is a book of predictability, which guides us into the future. Looking at verses 10 and 11 of our text, Paul said, you may approve the things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. You see, if you allow God's Word to, it'll help you predict things better. You say, well, how's that? Predict the lottery? No, that's not what I'm talking about. If you do something ridiculous and take a chance, I don't know if any of you saw the kid that slipped through the harness on the zip line, that little video. I saw that and I thought to myself, I will never get on a zip line. Now, just use that as a little simple illustration of God's Word gives us morality to see things through so that we don't mess up. See, there's certain things if you do, I can guarantee you how it'll turn out. If I could look at your social media accounts today, I'm not saying I want to, so don't bring them to me. But I'm just saying if I could do that, and all the ones that's hidden from everybody else's view, if I could see all of those today, if I could see your checkbook, well, scratch that. We don't have checkbooks anymore, do we? If I could see a printout of the debits and credits in your bank account, if I could look at that, see where you're going, if I could look at your Netflix account, your Prime account, and see what you're watching, I could predict where you're headed. Somebody's sitting there going, oh. Now, I'm not saying I want to do that, but I'm just saying that there's some things that are predictable in our life. And if I align my life up with God's Word, there's a good chance that I won't get in trouble for doing that. I won't get in trouble for doing that. My marriage won't fall apart because I had a moment of infidelity if I don't do that. It sounded better in my office, I can tell you that. But God's word helps us to predict it. We're to pull our life into the boundaries of God's word. Jesus taught in Luke 14:28, don't begin until you count the cost. The example he gives is for who would begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there's enough money to finish it. He's saying, count the cost. When you're tempted with something in this life, count the cost. Ask yourself, is that really wise to do? What could go wrong here? I don't think there's anyone in the house would get into a car with somebody noticeably drunk and take a ride with them. If you would, then half of Proverbs describes you. Some of you get that in a minute. Count the cost. Proverbs 3, verse 7 says, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase, so that your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father, the son in whom he delights. Happy is the man who finds wisdom, and the man who gains understanding. For her proceeds are better than the profits of silver, and her gain than fine gold. If money becomes the object you chase, if money becomes the thing that controls your life, you're going to have trouble. See, fear the Lord, depart from evil. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Yield to Him. Honor the Lord with your possessions and your first fruits of all your increase. Some people pay tithes cheerfully. Some people pay tithes begrudgingly. And some people don't pay tithes. I'm not trying to be mean to you today. This is the Word of God. If you want to be blessed in your life, you ought to try tithing unto the Lord. Give Him the first fruits of your increase. 10% of what you make, give unto the Lord. I'm not going to try to talk for somebody else today, but I'll tell you, in my life, it has made an absolute difference in my life. And see, money is one of the things that tries to rule our life. We can't allow money to be a master over us. God needs to be our master. Look at this. The way of the world might seem alluring. If we gravitate to it, it will weaken us spiritually. In other words, if everything in the world is alluring to you and you allowing yourself to get pulled into it, it will weaken you spiritually. Jesus said in Luke 21, verse 34, but take heed to yourselves, lest your heart be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of life, and that day come on you unexpectedly. For it will come as a snare on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. He gives us the remedy here. Watch therefore and pray always that you may be what? Counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. The Word of God will become predictable in your life if you will allow it, because it'll give you the ability to distinguish between the things that belong in your life and the things that don't belong in your life. You say amen to that? See, the text said that we are to be without offense. So we need to make sure that we live a life of integrity, a biblical life. Look at this statement. Choose the Bible, not culture, as your authority. The Lord gave me these three words. I didn't come up with them on my own. I hadn't really heard anybody use it in this fashion before or anything. The Lord gave me that because I believe what He's trying to say to us here at the Church of God is that the Bible needs to become more important in our life because it's what sets the truth in us. Jesus said in John 18:37, the reason I was born and came into this world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. I know there's been some pinch points in this sermon today. But see, God loves us enough to correct us. My dad spent a fair amount of time correcting me. And I'm a better man today for it. I've told you before when we went out after my dad had passed in August, that Christmas in early December, we went out to the illumination service, but it was raining in such bad weather we went later. I don't believe you got to come. I believe it was me and Gary and Mom and walked up there. And Gary and I were talking about how Dad set the bar high for us. And I made the comment about that. I said, yeah, boy, it's hard to reach. I mean, he really set it high. And Mom kind of peered out from under her little rain bonnet. And she looked at me and she said, aren't you glad he didn't lower it? There's a standard. And God will help us in our life if we will trust Him with it. Look at this last statement today. If God is powerful enough to get you to heaven, He can certainly sustain you in this world. Let's stand together. In conclusion today, to live a biblical life every day means we trust His Word to help us every day. Lord, I've shared what You placed in my spirit. Lord, I don't know. Sometimes I think I just can't quite say it like You're putting it into my heart. So, Lord, I depend on the Holy Spirit right now to stir in all of our hearts this morning. Lord, I need to grow more. I need more of Your Word in my life. I need to be intentional about ways, avenues to study Your Word more, to discuss Your Word more so that it becomes the most important thing in guide me in this life. Lord, I just implore You today to move in hearts and to pull us into this time of prayer. Well, I'm just going to open the altar up. I'm going to ask everyone that wants to grow spiritually, grow more spiritually, I'll say it that way, to come down and spend a few minutes in this altar asking God to let His love abound more and more in all knowledge and discernment in us. Would You do it this morning, oh Lord?
Grace, God.
just prayed just now while I was on my knee. We need your help. We need your word to come alive in us more than ever before. Lord, that's the only way that we gain more knowledge and more discernment, more judgment in our life, to make sure we don't step in the potholes of life, the pitfalls of life that try to trip us up. Lord, we're desperate for your help. Would you touch everyone that's yielding their heart to you right now, so that your power begins to transform them. The Word of God will come alive to transform them and renew them, the spirit of their mind. Oh God, we need you more than ever before in our lives to guide us, to empower us. And Lord, in the process of living in this life, Jesus says, use what happens to you as an opportunity to testify of his goodness. So Lord, empower us. Lord, as we read your word, when you were teaching us about the Holy Spirit coming, you said that one operation of the Holy Spirit is to bring things to your remembrance. If you are in the Word of God as you need it, the Spirit of God will bring a verse of Scripture to strengthen you in that moment. As we yield to you, Lord, do that work that's needed. I don't want to leave this building the same way I come in, and I have felt your Spirit enrich in my life today. Lord, there might be some things that you're bringing to our mind in conviction this morning. Maybe some things we're allowing into our life that we shouldn't allow in. Give us the strength, Lord, to clean it up. The power of the Spirit will help us as we yield ourselves more and more to your word. Do it in us, O Lord, we pray. Your grace is amazing. Your grace is amazing. And it helps us. But when the word is in us, just as Jesus was tempted by the devil, and the devil even tried to quote scriptures, Jesus used the word of God every time to push him back. That's the power of the word in us. Will help us push back. Lord, I pray before we leave today that anyone who is here that is struggling with life, I just encourage them in this moment to open their heart and their mind and say, Lord, I've been holding on to this grudge. I've been holding on to this situation. I've been upset about it long enough. In this moment right now, I'm giving it to you, O Lord. He said to cast our cares on him because he cares for us. There's somebody right now that needs to cast some care on the Lord so that you can see life from God's point of view. Would you do it, Lord, today? Before we share our scripture, better